Good evening. Good evening. My name is Chad Vaughn, and I'm the president of the Alumni Association, and I welcome you to the 2012 Blandy Lectures. I will, as with most gatherings this day, these days, remind you to please silence, mute, or turn off any kind of device that you might have that connects you with the larger conscience of the world that beeps or vibrates or anything such as that, so that we can hear about how we are all more connected with one another. Before we move, yes. Before we move on to our speaker and a presentation of the Halbrook Perry Award, I want to introduce the Dean and President of the Seminary, Doug Travis, who's going to welcome us and give us an update on the seminary.
Notice that word, brief. Actually, boy, those lights are bright. Cynthia and I will be doing an update on the seminary tomorrow morning at 10:30, is that right? I think that's right. So I'll actually defer until then, or wait until then to do that. I want to welcome all of you. It's delightful to see this many of you, to see this many alumni. It's really quite wonderful to see people who have been here over a 50 or 60 year period and to realize we have most of those classes represented. I want in particular, before we go forward, to recognize Ashley Brandon, Kevin Schubert, and Dave Sugano. Would the three of you please stand? I think all of you here this evening. These are the folk who have organized the Blandy Lecture, so thank them. And I saw Dusty somewhere. Dusty? Would Dusty McDonald, my predecessor, please stand? I was preaching one Saturday morning for the CCMV, and Dusty was there having just taught a class, and I said to him very simply, Dusty, I've known Dusty for 25 years. I said, Dusty, I've always had a great respect and admiration for you, but having been in this job, it's immensely deeper and broader than it was. So, you know. I also want to recognize again Bishop Magnus and Bishop Bailey, but would ask you all to stand up and introduce your wives. Bishop Bailey. It's wonderful to have you here, both of you, all of you. Chad, I think I've introduced everybody I need to recognize. I can't see real well out there, but I think I have. So, Chad, if you'll come back wherever you are, Chad. There you are.
And I will take a minute to recognize one other person. We have a wonderful advancement staff here at the seminary, but someone who is new to that team since our last gathering, and someone who really helps keep me connected as president living far away and the rest of the alumni steering committee, is Andrew West, who is our new director of alumni relations and the annual fund. So. Want to recognize his leadership in making this weekend a success as well. The next thing on our agenda tonight, before we hear from our speaker, is the presentation of the 2012 Halbrook Perry Award. And I think this is a citation, and we don't actually have a presentation tonight of the award. Is that correct? Is that okay? The award is forthcoming, but the citation is tonight. So I'd like to invite Ernest McAfee Jr. to come and join me down here at the podium. Ernest W. McAfee Jr., trusted pastor, visionary, creative, and tireless priest of the church, you have answered the call to serve and lead the people of God, doing whatever was needed in the parishes you have served, following retirement from active ministry. following completion of your MDiv degree at Southwest in 1985, you served parishes in the Diocese of West Texas, Texas, and Dallas, and earned a D.Min at Drew University. You authored Generations, published in 1997, about working with young adults in the church. Following your retirement as rector of St. Barnabas in Garland, you began to worship at Church of the Ascension, Dallas, and eventually served as pastoral assistant. He gave of himself generously, serving joyfully in any area where there was need, says the rector K. Ryan. While at Ascension, you became fully involved in their ministry to the Dinka, traveling to Sudan to teach theology and scripture to the clergy of the Diocese of Bor. And you coordinated efforts to extend Ascension's ministry to the Spanish-speaking residents of an apartment complex with which Ascension worked. When the Diocese of Dallas called you to serve a parish that had suffered the painful departure of its rector, you went in and built relationships with the people and developed trust. Your encouragement raised confidence and released vision in the English and Spanish speaking congregations, and helped them to identify mission goals, which included support for the neighborhood elementary school. Recruiting participation from local businesses, your congregation of less than 100 gathered over 500 backpacks and supplies for children at the school. You have strengthened bonds between the Spanish and English members of Christ Church and nurtured their faith by leading the congregation to create a common Sunday school for children, youth, and adults. Your vision caught the imagination of the people, and the program grew. Healing, purpose, spiritual growth, and renewed confidence have been the fruits of your ministry. Whether you are leading mission trips to Honduras, racing your bicycle at the top of your age bracket, I didn't write that, or ministering to people of all ages and cultures in the name of Christ, you epitomize the spirit of the Hal Brook Perry Award, giving the whole of yourself to life and ministry. And for that, we thank you.
This actually seems to be my year for awards in racing bicycles since 1998. I had previously won 2 state championship races. I've raced in 5 this year and won 3 of them. All 3 of those were team events. And there's something special about standing atop the podium with your teammates. I wish that every layperson, bishop, priest and deacon that have contributed to the ministry that I've had could stand here with me tonight. There's not enough room by any means. 2 of them are here. Kay Ryan, who was just mentioned as one of the priests, and one of the lay people, Diana McAfee, who's been hanging around with me for over 50 years. I'll make one other comment and then turn it back to Chad. Bishop Lambert this morning asked me if this was the award for being the oldest living graduate of the seminary. I told him no, just the oldest one still working full time.
Thank you, Ernie. Tonight, we are blessed to have Carol Howard Merritt with us. When we were discussing names for the 2012 Blandy speaker, her name quickly rose to the top. And for those of you who are visiting from the greater community, I'll remind you that this lecture series is sponsored and put together by the alumni of the seminary. And as such, we are spread around the country, and it's a wonderful thing to sit at that table and brainstorm from a broad spectrum of voices that we would, from which we'd like to hear, in support of the continued theological education of the community as it's gathered here, and the alumni as they return. Carol Howard Merritt's name, as I said, quickly rose to the top. She has had a recent life transition, as I was talking to her right before the lecture, and it's a good thing that I was talking to her. I would have introduced her as doing something that she's no longer doing. But until recently, she was a pastor at Western Presbyterian Church in Washington, D.C. She has recently, as I just found out, moved to Chattanooga, Tennessee, just up the street from me in Atlanta, where her husband is planting a new church, and she is pursuing her career as a writer and speaker and encourager of the church. While at Western Presbyterian Church, she founded a program, feeding and social services program, called Miriam's Kitchen, which welcomes 200 homeless guests for breakfast and dinner each day. She is the award-winning author of Tribal Church and Reframing Hope, both published by Alban Institute, and she has written numerous articles and blogs and is featured in the Christian Century and the Huffington Post. And she also co-hosts a weekly God Complex radio program, which you can hear podcast on the internet. We are delighted that she is coming to join us tonight to tell us what good things are going on in the church as she sees them. So welcome to the Seminary of the Southwest, Carol.
Am I on? Okay, great. We're in business. I wanted to thank you for this opportunity to be here in Austin, Texas. It's always wonderful to be here. I went to Austin Seminary, so any chance that I have to get back, I'm always happy to do it. And what a wonderful thing to be here at the Seminary of the Southwest. We just have always really appreciated this school and all that you've done. And I can't say enough about how wonderful that the hosting committee has been. And so thank you. Thank you for having me here. I grew up as a Southern Baptist, and I have to say, there's a lot of kinds of Baptists. I found that out when I moved to Rhode Island, but these were the mean kind. they weren't nice, and especially they weren't nice for a girl who was writing sermons on her free time and preaching them to stuffed animals. And they didn't know what to do with me. So I'm going to tell you this because you may find out, and so I'm just going to clear the air right at the beginning. I was feeling a call to ministry, and so I decided to become a missionary. And you know, when you're 17 years old, you're Baptist, and you want to become a missionary, you go to Moody Bible Institute. So I went to Moody Bible Institute for 4 years, and then came here to Austin, Texas, to Austin Seminary. It was a great, great change. I was very, very pleased about that. So, and it's great to see familiar faces and friends who are here. So thank you for coming out. I noticed something changed when I went on the computer and I was scrolling through the news, and so I saw this headline on the news, and the headline had this picture, and it was a picture of a young man. He was about 10 years younger than me, and he had on this beautiful saffron robe, and his face was extraordinarily peaceful, and I saw his robe was covered in blood. He was a Burmese monk, and he had been protesting the military actions that were going on, and they were protesting by taking their alms bowls and withdrawing them when they came to military families. And this, and then after that happened, there were just riots in the streets, and sometimes monks would be asleep, and people would come in, and they would beat them and carry them away. And we learned about all of this on the internet, scrolling through the news. But the reason why this was important, the reason why this was such a different change, look, am I supposed to stand there? Can you still see me? Is it okay? Okay, all right, all right. Okay, so I have a really hard time standing on one spot. Unless, you know, I'm preaching or something. But anyway, so the reason why this was so important, such a huge change, was because Burma wasn't allowing this sort of news to get out. But what had happened was that people had cell phones, and all of a sudden they were snapping pictures and taking these pictures, and all of a sudden this news that had always been suppressed by this government seeped out quickly, and people began to see the images that I saw, these men and their saffron robes covered with blood. And there was a stirring effect that reached across the globe. Now quickly, very quickly, the cell phones were turned off. There was no more communication. And again, the enclosed government kept things very quiet. But there was a shift there, a change there. And I think it's a change that we needed to be aware of, and we need to keep being aware of, because it's happening over and over again. As we heard this afternoon, when we heard the panel speak, we heard about the Arab Spring that was coming up and arising, and we began to see all of these things happening in Syria and in Egypt, and we began to read about it on a Twitter stream. So fascinating. And I remember one morning waking up on the reading my Twitter stream, and I clicked on this picture, and there was this woman, and she was in her burqa, and even behind the burqa you could tell that she was smiling broadly, and she was holding in her hands a steering wheel. And she was in Syria, and she was going out in this protest, and she was going to drive. And I learned in that moment about how women were finding liberation in this time and in this place. And then we saw the Occupy movement, people beginning with this urge, this longing, not only to speak out about economic injustice and inequalities, but there was something else that was going on. As you spoke to men and women at the camps, they would say, you know, we not only want to talk about a protest here and a protest there, but we want to imagine what a new community would be. And they often formed on social media. Over and over again, we saw it happening. And when peaceful protests were being broken up with pepper spray, we saw that happening as well. Things have been shifting, and we're watching it happen. And as we see it happen, I often think about those classroom days when I was in Austin Seminary, and they would talk about Hegel. And those of you who are fresh in seminary, that you probably know, you know, Hegel talks about this sweeping zeitgeist that happens within history, and things are always progressing, and they're always moving forward. Whoops. and this wheel of history is moving forward, and it's actually really kind of a very hopeful thing for us as progressives, for many progressive people who are people of faith, to think of the Spirit moving throughout history and always progressing. But what they were saying in our seminary classrooms 20 years ago when I went to seminary was that not only is this was progressing, this was our view of history, our view of philosophy, but many times that's breaking down. And you can think of that in a bad way, because you can think of the fact that that these things are breaking down and so we may not be progressing, but you can also think of it in a good way, because you can think of it in the light of the liberationist movement, and you can think of all of these voices that had been crushed by this meta-narrative, that had not been heard in former times, and all of a sudden these voices are now being heard, and this meta-narrative is breaking down. But these voices now that have been long silenced are now being heard. I'm sounding very utopian about the internet, aren't I? And I'm not. I know that there are problems. I know that this isn't the answer to everything. But I also know that there are shifts that are occurring. There are things that are happening with people organizing, with activism happening. There are things that are occurring that we need to be aware of. And as people of faith, we need to understand what's going on. And we need to understand that this theology that we have been talking about for a couple of decades is now kind of happening on this very real level that we're very much affected with on a day-to-day basis. Things are changing. And so is the, there we go. I'm totally confusing it, aren't I? I'm sorry. And there's a few things that are happening. And I just want to touch a bit on some of the things that were brought up this afternoon. And one of the things was a move to participation. And one of the main books that was brought up in this panel that we had this afternoon was Clay Shirky's Cognitive Surplus. And it's important, because we realize right now that there is this strong move toward participation that's happening. And so what is going on is that we have this on almost every facet of our lives, we have more participation and dialogue that's occurring. So, for instance, at one time, you might have watched the news, and you would sit down and you would watch the news, and Walter Cronkite would end each newscast with, do you remember?
And that's the way it is.
And that's the way it is. Now, it would never happen that way, because you have journalists and you have bloggers who get on these websites and they talk about the news, and then other commenters get on and they say, well, you know, that may be one perspective, but I see it this other way. And oftentimes these things turn out to be a little bit uncivil, but as especially on the Huffington Post, it gets kind of nasty over there. But you see that people are in conversation about the way it is. And it's no longer just sitting there and receiving information, but people are arguing and they're wrestling and they're thinking and they're challenging. And now journalists, they not only have to write an article, or they not only have to sit on the 5 o'clock news and say the way it is, but they have to be in conversation, and they have to be struggling with people, and they have to be thinking about different facts that are going on. And we see this now in our communities, because we see this shift oftentimes from just not just receiving information, but also wanting to struggle with it, also wanting to wrestle with it. We see it not only in the news, we see it not only with what we read, we also see it with entertainment and with hobbies. Clay Shirky says, you know, evidently we didn't want to be a bunch of couch potatoes watching television for hours and hours a day. Americans made television a part-time job, but all of a sudden, when we had the internet, when we were able to participate with things, we began to create things and build things like Wikipedia. We began to organize differently around different crafts or different beliefs, political beliefs, or even religious and spiritual beliefs. And so we as church leaders will need to wrestle with this. What is this going to look like as people not just wanting to receive the tradition, not just wanting to sit in the pew and taking it all in, but people who want to argue, who want to wrestle, who want to fight, who want to question, who want to deconstruct whatever authority we might have in the narrative that we might have? How can we respond? There are such interesting things going on all the time where people are doing this faithfully and they're responding to this new struggle that's occurring. And we can look at it. We can see how this is playing out in our everyday lives. Oftentimes we see it as the spiritual but not religious, or the nuns, N-O-N-E-S, when they ask, are you, you know, which sort of religious tradition, people will respond, I'm none of the above. But oftentimes they are spiritual but not religious. So we see this playing out where people are saying, well, I don't quite fit in that tradition, and I don't quite fit in that tradition, and I don't quite fit there, because I may believe something here, but I also believe something here, and I also believe something over there. And we may see that, and we may become very snarky and cynical and frustrated at that, and especially for people who take this as a profession and study it and take very seriously the tradition, this can be very scary to think that they're not just going to believe what we have to say or what history or tradition has to say, but they're going to be questioning it and they're going to be thinking about it and they're going to be picking and choosing. Some people I've read call it the cafeteria religion. They just pick and choose what they want. But what if we began to take those struggles seriously? What if we began to appreciate that deep yearning to wrestle with your faith, to not just take it in as an observer, as a couch potato, but to become actively involved with it, to allow it to inform not only that hour on Sunday morning, but every day of your life as you live and you work, you have your being. This could be an extremely exciting transition if we're able to let go of this idea that we should be the ones telling the story, that we should be the only ones in charge of the information, that we should be the only ones in charge of the narrative. And if we begin to understand that people have a cognitive surplus and they're able to wrestle with things a little bit more. I just realized I never explained what cognitive surplus is. What Clay Shirky said is now that there's a shift from television to more interactive forms of media and entertainment, what has happened is people have 6 extra hours of free time in their day. It's like a lot of time. It's that part-time job. And so he calls it a cognitive surplus. All of a sudden they have this surplus of brain activity in which they're able to work through different things. And oftentimes they work through spirituality. I want to also talk about the challenge of thinking about presence in a different way. We're talking about the overall shift that's occurred and the challenges that it presents to us. And this is a particular challenge I think that we need to be dealing with both as academics and as church leaders. We need to be wrestling with this idea of presence, There's a couple of ideas when it comes to presence, because oftentimes when people form communities online, there's a lot of spectrum of it, of communities. Right now, there's a chat going on. They may be watching this. I'm not sure what they decided, but there's something called Church CHS Chesakum. So CH is for church, SOC is for social, M is for media. And what this is called a hashtag. And a hashtag is something that you can use on Twitter. Twitter is 140 characters. It's a lot like a Facebook status if you're on Facebook. But when you put a hashtag, our hashtag for this lecture series is Blandy2012. And when you put a hashtag on your Twitter, on your 140 characters, that allows things to organize in a different way. And so this conversation becomes much larger. So things aren't just happening here in this room where we are flesh and blood in what many of my friends will call meat space. That's M-E-A-T space. But it's also, this is happening, this conversation is happening over Twitter. It's kind of interesting when you think about it, right? It's a great cloud of witnesses. I think. So we need to begin wrestling with presence. What does it mean to come together and to worship God on the internet? And many times it'll happen with worshiping communities that are actually on the internet, like on Second Life. If I can explain Second Life, I would say, imagine a cartoon, and there are characters on this cartoon screen, and you are one of the characters. It's called an avatar, and everybody else has a character as well. And you speak to each other, and you there's a whole economy on Second Life, and you oftentimes pray together and worship together, read books together, study together. And so there are churches there on Second Life, and many times you'll hear questions on Twitter about how do we have communion on Second Life? Or how do we have communion when there's a church that's happening in a like Darkwood Brew, and there's a church that's happening in a coffee house, but people are watching it on a live stream. How do you have communion? And is that really community that you're forming together? Many times people get extremely frustrated with this question. And if you are not involved at all in any sort of social media, I want to make sure that you can reserve your right to criticize until you're involved. because you kind of have to earn the right to criticize. You kind of have to earn the right to judge these things. But we need people who are thinking theologically about presence and what it means, and what it means to form community on the internet. And does it, I wonder, oftentimes, does it heighten the incivility? I, as was mentioned earlier, I was a pastor in Washington, D.C. for 7 years, and many, many people on both sides of the aisle said that incivility had been heightened like they had never seen before, and oftentimes it was because they thought it was because of the internet. And I often wondered about that. I often struggled with that. Why is it? Is it because that people can remain somewhat anonymous? Emmanuel Levinas, he's the Jewish philosopher, he talks about the epiphany of the face and about how we can see God in each other, and how when we are with each other in that face-to-face reaction, in that face-to-face moment, there can be an epiphany there. There's something divine that happens there. Are we missing that on the internet? But there is no doubt that worship and community forms there. And I have friends who will talk about a church in Second Life, and I'll say things like, well, don't you feel like you're kind of wearing a mask? Because when I'm on Second Life, I'm like 8 foot tall and real skinny. So, well, don't you feel like you're wearing a mask somehow? And they'll say, well, you don't think people in church are wearing masks? We're all wearing masks on Sunday morning at 11 o'clock. In fact, they'll say many times that they're able to be their truer selves there in that community. So what does that mean? Can we begin to think about this theologically? Can we begin to question it, both with the respect that new technologies bring, but also with the realization that there might be something missing. There might be something missing. Another challenge that we have is, and I think an opportunity, is the challenge and opportunity to organize community in a different manner. Let me give you a portrait. Whoops. I'm not sure what I'm doing. Let me give it, maybe it's my hair. Let me give you a portrait of the basic person in his or her 20s or 30s. I wrote a lot about this in Tribal Church. The person in his or her 20s and 30s, they will come into your church. And oftentimes, if we're thinking about reaching out to people in their 20s and 30s, we're thinking about, how are we going to have a playground in the parking lot? How are we going to have those young families in our church? But oftentimes, the person in their 20s or 30s, if you think about it in a broad spectrum, what you'll see is this. It's a person in a particular financial situation. Because within the last 20 or so years, we've had student loan debts that have skyrocketed. And so people are often starting their careers underground. We often have people who have had to move geographically. And so they're not able to be with their families or their friends, and their people of origin. And many times people have to change jobs at least every 2 to 3 years. 2.7 years is the average. And so you have people that are moving from place to place, many times for education, many times for job opportunities, many times so they can work for 2 years at an internship for free in order to maybe get a job at the end of it. So here we have people who walk into our churches and they're burdened by debt, and many times they've moved away and been uprooted from their communities. Oftentimes people aren't able to get married because we have this idea in our society that you have to be financially stable before you can get married. But the problem is that we have households that are based on two incomes, and so you have to have two incomes before you can have financial stability. And so people are in this difficult cycle, and over half of younger generations live with their mother or their father. And usually those are people in their 20s, are living in their parents' basements. So you can imagine if a guy is going to propose, he's probably not going to whip out the engagement ring in the parents' basement, right? Needs to be a little economic instability. Stability. And of course, we've heard about the employment situation. Oftentimes, employment situations for young adults are very difficult. Many times they have to work for free for years before they can get a job. Many times they're very lucky to get a job. If they get a job, it's usually without benefits. It's usually without any sort of health insurance. And many times it's part-time. So imagine what this person needs. He or she is entering into your church. The person doesn't just need to sit for an hour and listen to a lecture. They're going to need a community. And I mean not just the communities that we've been forming, but the communities that we're reading about in Acts, the communities where people take care of each other, their flesh and their blood and their bone, and they take care of their food, and they make sure that their kids are being fed. I mean that sort of community. And so the person walks into the church, and we need to begin to imagining communities that will be able to surround people, that will be able to listen to their needs, that will be able to hear what they have to say. I think oftentimes social media is often able to get to that base need of community. I know that within our church, when I was connected with people on Facebook, I learned more about them than in any other way. If somebody in their 20s got in an automobile accident, they didn't call the pastor. That was like the last thing that they did. They wouldn't call me up. If somebody in his or her 60s or 70s got in an automobile accident, I'd probably be number two on the phone list. But if somebody in their 20s or 30s was in an automobile accident, I'd read about it on Facebook or Twitter. It's the way that people form community in a new time, in a new place. And so this is my challenge to all of us today. I pray we're beyond this time of thinking that Twitter is just about what we ate for breakfast. Are we beyond that yet? We realize that there are organizing factors that are happening. We realize that there are calls for social justice. We realize that people are having governments that are restructuring and rethinking things because of much of what is happening in the breakdown of this meta-narrative that's occurring. So how are we we going to respond as churches? Can we begin to use social networking for social good? Can we become out on the forefront of using much of this for social causes and issues that we've been working on for years and years? Can we begin to take the instantaneous, the rapid fire, the quick and energetic energy that's on social media, that vitality, and can we begin to partner it with the amazing skill and organization and hard work and years of tradition and years of experience that churches have had with social justice? Can we bring those together and start working across generations without putting each other down, but beginning to work for incredible change? Can we begin to think about presence, not in a dismissive way, not in a way in which we just think that all the time that incarnation, flesh and blood, meets space community is always superior to what is happening in the internet, but can we begin to have a theology that reflects how a new generation thinks, how a new generation forms community? Can we begin to think about our churches in a different manner? And as we begin to have a podcast and we preach a sermon, can we realize that when we put that sermon on a podcast, that it spreads out, not just to our congregation, but to people on the ends of the earth? Can we begin to understand that using Twitter is just not about what we had for breakfast, but oftentimes it begins to form networks, it begins to form relationships with people who would never walk into the doors of our church and may never walk into the doors of our church, but that is a safe space for them to be able to communicate, to be able to talk to each other? And can we, in all of it, begin to think about community in different ways? Can we take this notion of sharing our lives with one another and understand each other in deeper and more meaningful ways? I didn't really understand the power of community until my father died. My father died, and I got a couple of cards from the people in my church. But I got questions and prayers and love over and over and over again on Twitter. It was the strangest thing, and I do love my church, and they were very, very good to me. But it made me understand that there was something going on that Twitter community in which we were able to form a deeper, maybe even, I can't really say that, a deep community there as well. I want to open it up for questions. And particularly, I often try to explain things like Twitter, or explain things like hashtags, or explain things like podcasts. I didn't do that. A podcast is kind of like a radio station that you can download on your phone, from the computer to the phone, to your phone, or to your iPod or MP3 player. If that makes any sense. But oftentimes, people are able to put sermons up on podcasts. And for instance, our church in Washington, D.C., it wasn't huge. It was that's always relative, isn't it? Yeah. But it was a couple hundred people on Sunday morning, but we would put the podcast up and another 600 people would download it. When it would come to, we were a little worried about it because we were afraid that if we would put the podcast up there that people would skip church, they'd just listen to it on the podcast. But what we found was two things. The first thing we found was that our attendance went up because it attracted more people. And also, when people were gone, they would tune into the podcast, and so they still had that connection with the church, even when they weren't physically there. The second thing we learned was that it was an incredibly important tool for our young adults. We had a lot of college students who would come to the church, and then they would leave for different jobs or internship opportunities, and they would stay connected with the congregation. In this time and age when people are moving around every couple of years, people need that spiritual connection even when they can't always form the physical one right away. And so we found that happening a lot. What? Are there any other? Are there any questions? I said other questions. Let me answer my own question. Yes. Well, I think the epistles themselves are a good indication because, and I'm talking more about the form rather than the text itself, but of course, you know, how did these communities form? It seemed as if they were reading these letters to each other. They were meeting together in small communities. They were reading these letters to one another. And they were encouraging each other through words. And they began to form these communities through these words and through these epistles. And so we have always been people who come together around words and around texts. And one thing that's happening with social media is that it's very textual, you know, it's very much word-based. It's almost a problem because, you know, people who have difficulty with the words, there's a digital divide when it comes to that. But we have, it's very much a part of who we are as Christians that we would be formed around words. Other things that really kind of inspire me and enlighten me is the idea of, the Great Commission. Is that just a Baptist thing? Did just Baptists say that? Okay. I mean, I know it's there for all of us, but it just seemed like a big thing that Baptists would say a lot. But, you know, reaching the ends of the earth. And this is particularly difficult for pastors, I think, who have a calling to social media. And not everybody's going to have this calling. You may be sitting here going, why am I even at this lecture? This is ridiculous. But there are people who have this calling to social media. And one of the difficult things that you struggle with as a pastor who's engaged with this is you have this flock and you have people who you're in community with, whom you love and you care for deeply. You're ministering with them and caring for them. And so, you know, how much time can you spend on tweeting? So, because you do have this certain responsibilities, right, to that flesh and blood community. But I know that as a person who does feel called to social media and who is interested in what it can do, I would often talk about it being a ministry to the ends of the earth. And when people sent out missionaries, they didn't say, well, how many butts are we going to get in the pew after this? They knew that they were just spreading the word, spreading the gospel, and doing it in important ways. And another thing that's coming to mind, there's this book called Linked, and I can never pronounce the author's name, but it's just a simple thing called Linked. And it's written by a mathematician, and he talks about internet theory a lot in it. And he talks about Paul at the very beginning of the book. It's not, you know, it's not a Christian book or anything, but he talks about Paul, and he says that when Paul went to spread the gospel, what did he do? Paul went to port cities. I mean, these were very strategic places where he knew that he would go and he would spread the gospel, and then the gospel would go out in these ships, and they would go and they would be spread to different continents. And that was a very strategic move by Paul and many of the first apostles and disciples. And this mathematician compared that with the internet. And he said that oftentimes there are hubs, or there are blogs, or there are websites, and many times these things are now our ports of today. And so if you think of those things, you know, kind of coming together in their natural conclusion, well, can we use these hubs, these internet hubs, and begin to spread the gospel? The problem with it many times is that you won't always be spreading the gospel to the neighbors, but it may be to somebody in India or China or to the ends of the earth. So that's another image that really inspires me a lot in this. Is there anyone else? Yes. Right, right. That's a great question. And if I can summarize it, there's people watching a live stream. I forgot to summarize yours. Basically, she's saying that she's reading a lot of blogs that seem to be ministers talking to ministers, right? And not necessarily evangelism. And I mean, one thing that you have to always be careful with social media is kind of that brass self-promotion. So, for instance, you know, a pastor might start a Twitter feed, and he or she gets on there every, you know, Sunday morning and says, we're going to have a service at 11 o'clock. Y'all come join us. And then, you know, nobody new comes, and she's like, it's broken. The Twitter feed is broken. Because many times social media is very much about the personal connection that's being made. And so it's just like life, you know, it's very rare that you can go up to a stranger and say, let me tell you about Jesus, and, you know, and that works. They go to your church. It just doesn't always happen that way. You need to form relationships with people. You need to become caring about them. You need to love them. And then oftentimes they will become a part of your community of faith or understand God in a different way because of that contact that you've had with them. So it's the same way with social media. It's, you know, I'm sure that there are a lot of people out there saying, you know, this is the way to Jesus, but whether that's a great evangelistic tool, I don't think so, but it works many ways, the same way that it works with life, that you're deepening these connections. But I think you're absolutely right about ministers just talking with one another. And that's one of the reasons why I really love doing the sermon podcast, because that wasn't geared to my colleagues. And it's something that I struggle with personally a lot. Like, well, who am I speaking to? Am I speaking to a wider audience, or am I just speaking to, are we just speaking to each other? And Twitter, I heard it just recently talked about as kind of a support group for pastors. And we need that, that's good. But I would like for us to go further. I would like for us to think about these tools and use them to change the world, you know? I hope that we would be able to use them to organize effectively and to create a just society. So for me, I think you're absolutely right. I think we have just scratched the surface of what these tools can mean and what they can do. I do know that people who are in the congregation, it's an incredibly important ministry tool. In fact, I don't know how I would be as connected with the younger members of our congregation without social media, mainly because of that pastoral care thing that I was talking about. Yes?
I'm very fascinated by the idea of the Pauline missionary methodology over against what it's developed into today.
Mm-hmm.
It follows the dynamic model that you set forth. It seems to me that a good argument could be made that the reason gathered communities were there were to further the mission on rather than to stop along the way. We begin dating what we've made there today.
Yeah.
And what I'm wondering is, you're not talking about some sort of a major shift that's being brought about by the use of information and technology to explain the method now in a different way to a different group of people. So we haven't reached a decade.
I absolutely believe that. I absolutely believe that this can be used in that way. I also think it's important time and a good time to be strategic, like you're talking about. The Presbyterian Church closes about 10 churches a month. I've heard the Episcopal Church closes 6 a month, is that right? Yeah. I was at a recent event with Dan at the Episcopal Church Building Fund, and they kept saying, well, these are the Episcopal Church's data and number, but here's the Presbyterians. it's like, you're using us to make you feel better, I think. But anyways, So yeah, I absolutely think right now we have, I know we love to sit around and talk about how poor we are, but we have incredible resources, incredible intelligence, incredible imagination, incredible love, incredible money resources. And I think this is an extremely important time to become strategic about not only the internet, but also about planting new communities. And where are we planting them? Where, you know, are we just planting them to be ends of themselves, or can we begin thinking in this apostolic manner, in this hub manner, or this internet sort of manner, and begin to spread out? One of the major things that has occurred, the shifts that have occurred, is organizationally, people have often thought like this, And they still do. You know, this sort of hierarchy still exists. But we've shifted to more like this. So people are connected in different sorts of ways. And so organizationally, you know, the person here on the top used to be the person in charge. But here, it's often the person who's most connected, the person who's in that hub, the person who's in kind of that port city in many ways. And this person may not be the person with the title, or it may not be the person with the most education, or it may not be, you know, whatever that traditionally has meant. But it's the person who's the most connected. So yeah, I think it's great to be strategic at this moment, because we do have, we're in this transitional period in all mainline churches. And we can sit back and be very snarky and talk about social media and how stupid it is, or talk about technology and why would you ever want to be a part of that? That's just dumb. Or look at a new generation and say, spiritual but not religious, that's just ridiculous, you know. Or we can become engaged with what does this mean to struggle and wrestle with our faith, to be participants in it, and to be connected and organized in different ways. Yes? Yeah. Right. Yeah. You know, the statistics, they change all the time. The last statistics I saw were that that Twitter was used more by my generation, which is Generation X, people who were born between 1961 and 1981, and that people who are younger than that weren't tweeting as much as people who are sort of in that critical kind of career mode. But I heard today somebody talking about that on the panel, that for younger generations, people would tweet much more. I know working with campus ministry for the last 14, 15 years, that emails don't do very much any longer. So texts often work, Twitter, Facebook, but texting often works. But yeah, email, I mean, who doesn't hate email? It's a drag. I hate email. So yeah, it's becoming, I mean, it's a necessary evil at this point, I think, for a lot of people. So I'm not sure. Anybody in their 20s want to tell me what's the major form of communication? What would you say? Text. 100% what?
Read rate?
So, tell me. Explain that.
People always read their text messages.
Okay.
They don't always open emails. They don't
always open. So she said texting has 100% read rate. They don't always open their emails. They don't always check their social media. But texting, you always hear, I mean, you always get the message across. Yeah. Yes. Right. I mean, there's certainly tools out there where you can begin to, you know, pinpoint violent areas or, I don't know, there's a whole bunch of problems that would come with that because of, you know, real estate and all that sort of things. But yeah, I mean, there are things that we can do. I think for so many years we've been so worried about our own numbers and our own demise and our own stuff, and we have pet projects, but we haven't been thinking in that way. So I do think, I'm thinking of, Clay Shirky has like a TED Talk that's out. It's time, huh? Yeah, okay. He's coming out with the poll. but anyways, he has a TED Talk that talks about how people are organizing around certain areas where there is violence. And this is something that's kind of global, but certainly it could be used on a local level. But it's a great question, and it's something that we should be struggling with and we should be thinking about in our churches. Many times we're not thinking about what's happening right outside of our doors in our churches, so I think that's an excellent thing. So thank you all for coming out, and I just appreciate your curiosity and appreciate you taking this time.
Well, I was just going to, I don't know if this is, there we go. Remind you all who are visiting from the community that Carol will preach tomorrow at the chapel service at 11:45 in Christ Chapel, and then deliver the second Blandy Lecture here at 2 o'clock in Knapp Auditorium. If you're here for the alumni convocation, please make sure you look on the back of your name tag at the schedule for tomorrow and show up. The first event tomorrow is breakfast at 9 a.m., morning prayer 9:30, the Alumni Association meeting in here at 10:15, and then we follow with other things after that. And we look forward to seeing you tomorrow. And at this time, I believe that we'll open up the partition here and we'll move on to a dessert reception in Howell Dining Hall just behind us here. Thank you for coming tonight.